Hi, my name is Lauren White. I am a postdoctoral fellow at the National Socio-Environmental Synthesis Center. I'm an infectious disease researcher and quantitative disease ecologist, and my research focuses on the interplaying roles of the environment, human health, and animal health. At SYNC, I've been working on understanding how movement behavior of animals, like pumas or cougars, leads to disease transmission and it interacts with human changes to the landscape. Given the current conditions over COVID-19, I was asked to provide an introduction to disease modeling for our staff here at SYNC. The field of mathematical modeling in infectious diseases is critical for tracking and understanding epidemic dynamics. It is a broad field, and a variety of approaches are used. For example, statistical approaches use gathered data over time on the spread of an epidemic, who it affects, and the health outcomes to determine the relationships to other factors like age, underlying health conditions, and location. Another approach is to use machine learning to develop models. These rely on artificial intelligence and sweeping data mining techniques. We can also have what are mechanistic models. These are based on the underlying processes that lead to the spread of disease. In this case, we are specifically thinking about how one individual contacts another and the probabilities governing whether or not that contact event leads to transmission. There are several different types, but some of the primary differences that you might think about in these models are whether or not they're continuous through time, or whether they occur in discrete time, and whether or not there is an element of stochasticity. By stochasticity, I mean whether or not the modeler assumes that there is an element of chance that comes into play as to whether or not an infection event actually occurs. My work often uses compartmental models, which are a type of mechanistic model. You may have now heard of SIR models, or susceptible infected recovered models, in the context of COVID-19. These can estimate key parameters or variables used in mathematical equations that are needed to understand disease dynamics. You may have seen some of these variables in different studies showing things like incubation period or duration of infection. These models can help us link data across scales, so we can go from essentially knowing something about an individual to scaling up to an entire population. They can also help us study control measures that help us to flatten the curve of disease spread, as I'm sure you've probably heard in relation to COVID-19. For example, what happens if we implement social distancing measures? These models can also help us explain and observe patterns of what modelers call covariates, which are factors that may help us predict outcomes. In this case, we are looking at climactic variables and the group size to explain disease outcomes. All of this is to say that disease models can have very different applications and can be used in very different settings. SIR models are sometimes called dynamic, meaning that they change continuously through time. To mathematically model continuous change, we must use a set of ordinary differential equations, or ODEs. If you had calculus, you may recall that such equations help us model and predict complex systems. SIR models are compartmental, such that we think of individuals belonging to discrete groups or states, either infected or uninfected or exposed, for example. The processes that allow us to predict spread are based in this idea often called the law of mass action. That is, everyone is mixing together randomly, and we assume that there is an equal likelihood that any individual can get infected. We know this isn't necessarily true, but it's a really great starting point to understand disease spread. A good analogy comes from the ideal gas law, where we might consider individuals like gas particles that randomly bump into one another. Think of individuals in orange being susceptible, while the red ones are infected, and the gray ones are recovered. The Washington Post has a really great graphic simulator where they kind of show this in action, and also the effect of what happens when some of these molecules stop moving, which is basically a proxy for social distancing. So how do we actually model the transmission process in this context? Transmission is a function of the number of susceptible individuals. That's our susceptible compartment here in orange, the number of infectious individuals shown here in red, and the sort of ambiguous transmission rate or transmission function, beta. putting that into action in a mathematical context, we get back to our SIR model, that susceptible, infected, recovered, or removed model. For that, we have equations corresponding to three discrete classes. The first equation represents the rate of change of susceptible individuals through time. That's simply the number of susceptible individuals times the number of infected times the transmission rate beta. This quantity then moves positively into the number of infected individuals. Then we lose a certain number of infected individuals per time based on how long the infection lasts. This is our recovery parameter here, gamma. What we get through time then is a decreasing number of susceptible individuals, an infectious peak, and an increasing number of recovered individuals. This is obviously very simplistic. We don't have things factored in like births of hosts, deaths of hosts, or an incubation or an exposed period for hosts. So for looking at real diseases like COVID-19, this would be a more complex system of equations. This is some great work done out of Aaron Mordecai's Stanford lab, and I've included a link to their GitHub site here. They describe the COVID process in a more complex way. Here we have the number of susceptible individuals moving into an exposed or incubation class. Exposed individuals can either be asymptomatic and progress directly to recovery, or they can be presymptomatic and move either into a severe or more minor type of infection. The severe infection, of course, can lead to hospitalization and death. This brings us to an important quantity that you may have heard of called the basic reproduction number, or R0. This represents the number of new cases that come from a single infectious individual in an entirely susceptible population. This is a quantity representing the multiplication of three things: the transmissibility of the pathogen, the contact rate of the hosts, and the duration of the infection. It's important to note that this is a dimensionless number. It's not a rate. Dimensionless numbers help us understand general properties of a physical system that is relevant regardless of scale. They are widely used in science. In our case, this dimensionless number gives us an idea of what the outbreak is going to do. Another way to think about this mathematically is to think about the basic reproduction number as a tipping point. If R0 is greater than 1, we expect the disease to spread and for there to be an outbreak. If it is equal to 1, then the disease is what we call endemic. That is, it's spreading consistently in a population without really taking off. We can assume that the pathogen is spreading on average to one more person per single infected individual. Finally, if R0 is less than 1, we would expect the outbreak to die out in the population. It's really important to note that this quantity, R0, is specific to the pathogen, its context, and the mathematical models that are used to derive it. Perhaps you've seen figures like this, where diseases are arrayed on this range of R0, but we actually know, for example, that measles has an R0 ranging from 12 to 18, depending on the context. Although we can think of diseases being on a spectrum, it's just as important to remember that it's always situation specific. Recent estimates of COVID-19 seem to be in the range of 2 to 3.5, although there have been some higher reported estimates. However, because of limited testing, we have little data on how many people a single person carrying COVID-19 can infect. That means that these estimates of R0 and other model parameters are inherently very uncertain. This should give you a sense about why there is so much uncertainty about the path of COVID-19 and why there is so much discussion about models and the need for data right now. We can see that these same quantities that we saw on an earlier slide, transmission, contact duration, can serve as ways that we can reduce the rate of spread. We can do things to reduce transmission like social distancing, hand washing, and wearing masks. Preventative action to limit infection, like vaccination, leads to what is called herd immunity. That is, that so many people have this vaccine-induced immunity that a disease outbreak is less likely to be successful. So when enough people have been vaccinated, we can reach the tipping point to herd immunity. Until we get a vaccine for a new disease, it will spread. We can't actually change the duration of the infection, but we can do things like self-isolate, quarantine, and provide symptomatic treatment. None of these actions are necessarily mutually exclusive to any of these three categories, but they're just an idea on how we can go about changing the basic reproduction number through our own actions and interventions. A lot of my own research has focused on asking, what if these compartmental models, which assume that everyone has an equal likelihood of infection, don't actually capture epidemic behavior? This is a contact tracing figure from the SARS outbreak in the early 2000s. That is, it's a depiction of who came into contact with whom. For that particular disease, it turned out that there were super spreaders, which are individuals like Mrs. M, who are causing a really high, disproportionate number of secondary cases. Typically, this is due to individual differences in behavior and physiology. A tool that is used to help trace contacts is network science. Here, the nodes, shown in red, represent individuals, families, or geographic locations. The edges, or lines, between the spheres represent potential contacts, some of which result in transmission of the disease, and some not. Network science in this way, or network epidemiology, can help us understand, for example, how actions like social distancing can be effective. In this case, this is a simulation showing disease spread for a pretty connected network. So if we imagine that all of these nodes are people, it seems like everyone is getting infected except for perhaps this little holdout over here. However, if we implement social distancing, which essentially just allows us to make our networks more disconnected and more disparate, we can effectively limit the rate of spread. In this case, it's just one cluster of this really, really modular network that ends up getting infected. I'll just close with some final observations, which are related to thinking about how and why we develop models. I like to refer back to this important research paper by Richard Levins from the 1960s. He postulated that a single model cannot have all three of these important properties, that is, precision, generality, and realism. For example, we could have a model that's general and precise, or a model that's realistic and precise, but not a model that's all three. In science, we develop models for different reasons, and sometimes we want to maximize one of these goals over the other. General models tend to be simpler, more flexible, and may lead to general understanding of principles, like important properties of disease transmission. Other models we need in order to give us the best possible predictions for a specific disease in a specific setting. So it is important that when we develop models, that we are thinking about the quality of our data that we are using to inform them and the desired outputs. It is also important to reflect on why we're developing the models and what we aim to get out of them. All of these factors will affect how these models should be interpreted. Are they models that help us foster a better understanding, or are they models of prediction? Coming back to the big picture of mathematical models of infectious disease, we have to remember that different models that have been developed with different underlying assumptions will likely, or can, give different predictions, maybe why we are getting some conflicting results. It's important to acknowledge that these are decision-making tools. They're not infallible. As George Box, a famous British statistician, said, all models are wrong, but some are useful. As we continue to evaluate studies that are coming out related to COVID-19, and evaluating evidence for decision-making, it's really important to think about the underlying assumptions leading to the results, and to ask about those assumptions and consider them carefully. I hope this has been a helpful overview and introduction into a really tiny slice of what infectious disease modeling entails, and I really appreciate you taking the time to listen.